And good morning and welcome to the 14th meeting of the Citizens' Participation and Public Petitions Committee in 2022. And our first item this morning on the agenda is the consideration of continuing petitions. And the first of those is petition number 1862, which is to introduce community representation on boards of public organisations delivering lifeline services to island communities. Now, this petition was introduced by Rona Mackay, Angus Campbell and Naomi Bremer on behalf of the Youth Economic Task Force. And it urges the Scottish Parliament to encourage the Scottish Government to introduce community representation on the boards of public organisations delivering lifeline services to island communities in keeping with the Island Scotland Act 2018. We last considered this petition on the 4th of May, and on this specific issue, we thought it would be useful to invite the Minister for Transport to provide further evidence, and I'm delighted that we have the Minister, Jenny Gilruth, MSP, with us this morning. And I think remotely... we have Fran Pasiti, Director of Aviation, Maritime, Freight and Canals, Transport Scotland. Oh, sorry, I didn't mean that. I couldn't see the small type in your nameplate. Once your job description is on there, there's little room left for your own name. But welcome to you both. The members have a number of questions they would like to explore this morning. So we're quite happy to move to those, Minister, unless there's anything you particularly want to say before we do. OK. I mean, I expect this will be a relatively short session this morning because we are focusing in on the particular issue in hand. So thank you very much for your time. And I'm going to invite David Torrance to lead the questioning.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Do you agree with former Transport Minister Graeme Day, MSP, that it is neither tenable nor credible that island residents are not represented on boards of organisations providing lifeline services to their communities?
So in relation to the quote itself, I don't think I've seen the quote in context, and I'd maybe be grateful if the committee could share that with me. But I recognise very much so the need to do more in relation to islander representation on boards in particular. This has been a matter that obviously predates my time in office, but has affected island communities in recent months. And in a number of my representations with island communities on a matter of different matters, most predominantly I would say in relation to ferry services, this has been raised consistently. I should make the committee aware that one of the petitioners, Angus Campbell, has also been asked to lead on the consultation work in relation to Project Neptune. So he is involved in some of that wider work which will seek to consult island communities on the governance and provision of ferry services. And some of those changes might of course look at directly the issue that the petition is considering. So I just want to make the committee aware of that. But in the principle of the member's question, I very much agree there is more that we will need to do in that respect. I think I should update the committee additionally that earlier last month I updated Parliament on two different appointments. So we now have Morag McNeill, who has been formally appointed as the chair of CIMAL, and we also have Murdo McClellan, who's been appointed as a non-exec. He is an islander on the CIMAL board, which is progress. But I very much recognise that more needs to be done here, and I'm committed to working with Angus Campbell and others in how we will deliver that as a government.
Thank you.
Just for information, can I say that it was in a members' business debate in September 2021, led by Alistair Allen, on reserved seats on boards for islanders, and the Minister was replying to Alistair Allen in that debate. That's where the source of Mr Torrance's quote came from.
Thank you.
Mr Torrance.
Thank you. Minister, you suggested in written evidence that there's alternative ways for island communities to engage with public bodies other than through places on boards. Are these alternatives really fit for purpose? If they are, why do you think island residents continue to press for a voice on the board of relevant public bodies?
I think that's a fair observation from the member. There are a range of different ways, as he's highlighted, that islanders can get involved in some of the board activity more generally, though not directly in the board necessarily itself, if they're not sitting on the board. So a good example of that would be the CalMac Communities Board, which is chaired by Angus Campbell, one of the petitioners. And I've worked very closely with Angus since January in relation to a number of issues on the Clyde and Hebrides Ferries Network. So that board is a really good example of how islanders' views can be taken account of. But there's not just the Communities Board in relation to ferry services. There are a plethora of different boards that exist in our island communities, particularly in relation to ferry services. And the committee might be aware that in my update to Parliament on the 9th of September in relation to Project Neptune, I outlined an alternative approach to resilience in relation to ferry breakdowns on the network, which looks to engage with a wide range of organisations as and when there are prolonged periods of disruption on the Clyde and Hebrides network, and members will be aware of some of those challenges in recent months. So over the course of recess, as an example, I convened a resilience meeting that looked at engaging a number of different representative boards on these island communities, not just, of course, those who work in CalMac and in CIMAL, but actually who live in our island communities. And I think that's a responsibility I hold as Minister, to engage with island communities when there are sustained periods of disruption. So there are other forums in which islanders can have their views taken account of. One way is through the Communities Board, as I've alluded to, but there are other boards and mechanisms that exist in island communities. I think there is a requirement for us to look further at what more can be done, and there are upcoming appointments in relation to the David McBrain Board, and I was in discussion with Bran about this prior to committee, and the process will be shared with me later today in relation to that. I'm really keen to safeguard in the future that we can make progress. I've given examples of two appointments in recent history that have evidenced progress in the last year, but it's important we continue to drive that as a government, and so I look forward to receiving further information to these new appointments later today, and I'd be more than happy to share further detail on what that process looks like with the committee.
Thank you for that, Minister. I have no further questions, Convener.
Mr. Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. Minister, in your written evidence, you talk about individuals having to have the skills, the knowledge and experience to ensure that that takes place. But that may in itself limit the number of individuals who are able to participate in that whole process because they come from a specific circle or they're from a specific location. That in itself is causing some difficulty. So do you believe there's an opportunity for training opportunities to try and influence that process so that individuals can be given that, that extra support that gives them the chance? Because otherwise you will be excluding individuals from the pool that might well be advantageous to ensure that they do get the chance to participate.
Absolutely. I recognise there's more, I think, that we can do in this space in relation to training and supporting the development of the necessary skills and expertise that are required for these appointments. And Fran may want to say more on why that's so important, but I recognise there are challenges in that respect. Before I came to give evidence this morning, I wasn't aware that this committee was an all-male committee. And I look at this committee and I wonder, there might be more that all parties can do in this Parliament in relation to female representation. So there is a challenge, I think, here to government in relation to how we can deliver that. There's a challenge to political parties always on matters of representation. But Fran may want to say more in relation to the skills and expertise and to the current expectation that we would place in relation to these bodies and how they would engage with and support the development of those skills going forward.
Thank you very much, Minister. We do recognise that challenge that you have highlighted. And in previous recruitments where we have sought to encourage applications from island communities, we have found that the combination of what can be quite specific technical skill sets and a geographic restriction or a knowledge of island communities has limited the pool of applicants that we've received. To counteract that, we have we've adjusted the approach. So you will see in the advert for non-executive directors for the David McBrain Board, which will be published in the course of the next few weeks, we have made it an essential criterion of one of those roles, rather than a desirable, but an essential criterion of one of those roles, that applicants have a good understanding or knowledge of the issues affecting island communities, and that will allow us to widen the pool of applicants that we attract. We've also been far more proactive in how we publicise those roles and make people aware of the opportunities, so that we're not only promoting those opportunities in the kind of well-worn kind of professional press or media. So we are advertising the roles in the Gaelic language. We are encouraging local authorities to disseminate the opportunities through their own community frameworks. We are using the Scottish Islands Federation to try and help us promote those opportunities. And we are encouraging island residents in our routine engagement with them to try and stimulate interest and awareness of the opportunities to encourage people to apply.
We're advertising on the vessels as well, are we not?
We are.
Which I think is quite important, actually, in terms of the opportunities that are available to island residents.
Thank you. Thank you, Camilla.
Mr. Ewing.
Yes, could I just raise with the Minister the fact that the focus of the petitioners is particularly on High Isle. The petition generally asks that there be representation from islands on public bodies having a responsibility for lifeline services to islands. But the particular focus, when one looks at the detail of what they seek, relates to High Isle. And I appreciate the Minister has responded quite a lot in relation to ferries, but I think the focus was very much on High Isle. And what they specifically have suggested, as far as I can see, is that there should be three seats allocated for specific island groups, Western Isles, Orkney and Shetland, and not excluding other island groups. And I just checked the web to see the size of the Board of High Isle, because one doesn't want, I think, Minister, to have boards that are overwieldy in numbers. I mean, Cairngorm Park has got 25 members, just for example, which is too many, in my humble opinion. But High Isle, I think, has only got 8. And therefore, as far as I can see, maybe I've got that wrong. If I have, I apologise. But given it seems to be a relatively small board, it does seem to me that there would be a lot to be gained by adding the island voice, an awful lot to be gained from adding the island voice. And I haven't raised this with Ingalls Lyon, and I'm sure High Isle, if they were here, would say that they engage, as they've got procedures to engage with islands. Of course they have, and we've heard about that before. But, you know, I just wonder if we could get a specific response, either today or after reflection and consultation with High Isle, which I think would only be fair to them, because I haven't raised this with them and I haven't raised this with you. But it does seem to me that what they specifically asked for has a certain rationale and force behind it and could be accommodated without making the governance of High Isle unwieldy or cumbersome, and could really add quite a lot of accountability and scrutiny and a feeling of belonging from people in the islands who really do feel, as you know, Minister, very remote and detached from things from time to time.
I'm prepared to be wrong on this, Convener, but my reading of the petition was that the High Isle example was used as an example of lifeline services to island communities, and it wasn't per se focused only on High Isle. And in relation to lifeline services to island communities, therefore, I think we're really talking about three boards. So we're talking about CMAL, David McBrain, and we're talking about High Isle. Now, in the context of High Isle, I think there are 6 members of that board, not 8. So if we were to add 3 members to that board, the composition would significantly alter. I'm not saying that I'm against it. I'm sympathetic to the proposal, but you're right to say, Mr. Young is right to say, Convener, that I would like to take this to High Isle directly to speak to them about this proposal. It is a relatively small board. In fact, in terms of the membership of all of the boards, they're relatively small in number, and some of the challenge relates to how you could recruit, therefore, the necessary requirements around about the skills and expertise that Mr. Stewart was asking about, and at the same time assure for islander representation within that. But I'm happy to write to High Isle on the point the member has addressed. I'm not necessarily sure I would agree with the petitioners on 3 members of that board coming from island communities, given that it only has 6 members at this current time. However, I think there is more that we can do in relation to formalising islander voice on these boards and ensuring that they are heard properly and their views are taken account of. Fran may want to say more in relation to High Isle. I know she met with High Isle last week.
Thanks very much, Minister. Mr. Ewing, there are 6 non-executive members on the High Isle board at the moment, and there is an opportunity for us to recruit a successor to one of the incumbent non-executive directors in the coming months, and we'll apply the same principle that we have in relation to the David McBrain and the CMAL boards of seeking to encourage island representation on the board to the extent that we can. I would commend High Isle for all that they do in their community engagement. They do dedicate a significant amount of resource to understanding the issues that affect the communities in all 11 of the airports that they operate. But that operational engagement and discussion with island representatives on the operational issues affecting their specific communities is not a substitute for making sure that we have that at a strategic level and making sure there's that customer focus at a board level. So agree with the principle, and from discussion with the High Isle chair, there is a welcome, there's an acceptance of that principle, so we will take that forward. We will, as with all board recruitments, have to look at the composition of the board, the number, the total skills requirements, so that we are getting the right balance of skills, to affect the strategic challenges of the organisation at the time of the recruitment.
Yes, thank you. I think it might be helpful, Convener, if we could maybe just share some of the detail of the proposals that the petitioners have put, which I have skimmed. I haven't gone into it fully here to do justice to the petitioners. Maybe if we could copy that to the Minister, I think it's... and then if the Minister has any further comments, given the generally positive response, then we could see what they are. Thank you.
We can certainly do that. The information's in the public domain, but we can make sure that the Minister is aware of that. Mr Sweeney.
Thank you, Convener, and thanks to both for coming this morning. And I just wanted to ask, in relation to the Caledonian Maritime Assets Limited, David McBrain Limited and Highlands and Islands Airports Limited, in terms of those boards, what does the selection procedure actually look like and how is it determined? So there is obviously a power structure in terms of who's picking people to go on these boards. How does that process actually work in practice?
I'm happy to allow Fran to talk you through the process itself. As Minister, obviously, I will need to sign off on some of these appointments, so it might be best that Fran talks you through the technical detail of the requirements in relation to the board or the application process itself, and then how candidates are sifted, for example.
Okay, thanks very much, Minister. So all three boards, each of the positions on all three boards are ministerial appointments, so the decisions are ultimately taken by ministers. For the three boards, they are regulated appointments, which means that the recruitment process itself is subject to the code and it is overseen by the Ethical Standards Commissioner, and that ensures a degree of impartiality around the process. The starting point for any of the recruitments is to identify the skill sets that are required on the board, and those will change over time depending upon the particular challenge that the organisation faces. We will regularly have a skills matrix for each of those boards in place. We will review that and will identify the skills that are needed. And we do recognise that included in those skills is a knowledge of island life and making sure that island representation is at the forefront of the board's consideration. We will use that to identify the number of board positions that are needed and the particular skills for the vacancy that has arisen. And we will agree those with the ministers and with the Ethical Standards Commissioner. In some instances, the Ethical Standards Commissioner will ask for a representative to be a party of the recruitment panel. That's a matter for the Ethical Standards Commissioner themselves, based upon the sensitivity of the recruitment. So, for example, there was an independent panel member on the recent CMAL recruitment. There will be one on the forthcoming David McBrain recruitment. And the Minister will sign off on the recruitment panel. The recruitment panel will typically have a representative from Transport Scotland representing ministers as the shareholders' interest in that recruitment. If considered appropriate by the Ethical Standards Commissioner, someone representing the Commissioner's officer, and a third panel member, and that third panel member will ensure that there is diversity in the panel itself, but will also reflect the particular skills or expertise. So in circumstances where, for example, we're looking for someone with particular maritime knowledge or a particular other skill, the board member will reflect that requirement so that we can adequately test it through the recruitment process. We have, in recent rounds, for example, in the CMAL recruitment, sought to include island representation on the panel so that there is a fair assessment of the candidate's understanding of issues affecting island life. So in the recent CMAL recruitment, we were supported by Malcolm Burr, who's the Chief Executive Officer of Western Isles Council. And he was very supportive in that process and actually brought a great deal of insight both to assessment of applications and offered us invaluable advice on how we improve, how we market and increase awareness of the advertising or the opportunities that exist. We then run the process which is set out by the Commissioner's office. So we advertise, we accept applications, we sift those applications, and then we test it interview. The panel will make recommendations to Minister. The Minister has an opportunity to meet candidates should she wish to do so, and then ultimately it's a ministerial appointment. But those steps and measures are in place to make sure that it is as transparent as it can be, as inclusive as it can be, and that, I mean, it recognises that every one of these appointments is unique, but there's a consistency and a transparency to how we go about doing them.
Thank you very much for that. And it does seem like a rigorous process in terms of ensuring technical competence. And I guess there's a tension there between the ideal of having, you know, representation that might be severely limited in terms of the population base you're drawing from. I'm just wondering whether there is a way of actually providing continuous professional development or an ability. And this isn't just in relation to transport-related boards. I mean, this is a wider issue across government. I mean, for example, I'm dealing with significant issues with community housing association boards in Glasgow, mm-hmm. and a tension with the regulator saying a lot of these boards don't have the necessary technical competence, mm-hmm. and then there's a pressure to take control away from communities. So I'm wondering whether there's a wider cross-government approach to trying to improve the continuous professional development opportunities for people who are eager to participate but maybe don't have that technical capability, yeah. that is necessary to pass a selection panel like that.
So I think for a cross-government approach, it wouldn't sit with me as Minister for Transport, but I'm happy to... I'm not necessarily sure in terms of the cross-government approach which minister it would sit with. I think I'll take that away and speak to officials about how we can better deliver that, because I recognise some of the tension that Mr Sweeney talks to. And, you know, in terms of board appointments, you tend to get a demographic element to it, if I may say so, and a gender element to it. Mm. And that skews representation of the public, bluntly, if we don't get the right people into these posts. So there is an ask of government here around about public appointments in terms of how we can upskill the population and empower them to apply for these positions. So I'll take it away and speak to officials around about a whole government approach, which wouldn't sit with me, but I recognise some of the tension here that the member speaks to in terms of how do you get those skills and the necessary experience whilst at the same time taking cognizance of, for example, in this instance, Islanders' views in terms of delivery of lifeline services.
Okay, thank you for that.
Okay, colleagues, thank you. Well, thank you very much. That was actually very constructive. Thank you very much, Minister. Ms Panchiti, I suspect I got it wrong first time in my confusion. So thank you both very much for attending, and I'll suspend the committee for a few moments. Thank you. Welcome back. And our next petition this morning is petition number 1856, Support the Taxi Trade. And this was lodged by Pat Rafferty on behalf of Unite. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to protect the future of the future of the taxi trade by providing financial support to taxi drivers, setting up a national stakeholder group with trade union driver representatives, and reviewing the low emission standards and implementation dates. I'm delighted to say that we're joined this morning by Stephen Grant, although on audio only, regrettably, on behalf of Unite, who is representing the petitioner this morning, and by Robert McLean and Murray Fleming on behalf of the Scottish Taxi Federation. So good morning to you all and welcome to the Public Petitions Committee. We've heard quite a lot of evidence on this subject. We have also collated quite a lot of evidence too, and so members have quite a number of questions that we want to put, and so we'll move to those if you're happy for me to do so. But I thought that just by way of an introduction, I would ask a kind of general question, because the situation, of course, is fluid. Talking to taxi drivers locally in my own authority of East Renfrewshire, it's moved on even since we last considered the petition a few months ago. So I wonder if our witnesses this morning might like to briefly outline the main challenges currently facing the taxi industry, given that the situation is very different now to when the petition was submitted in early 2021. And I will come to you, first of all, Mr. Grant, and because we can't see you, we'll have to hope you speak up and clearly. Good morning.
Good morning. Thanks, Pat, for listening to me today, and I'm sorry about my camera issues. Well, basically, the issues facing the taxi trade are critical at the moment. We really are fighting for our survival. We are looking at an LEZ zone being enforced in June 2023, and this is all in the midst of a dysfunctional new and used taxi market, as well as financially distressed operators who are just coming out of a pandemic, and we're now into a cost of living crisis that just means that they don't have the money. Even if the vehicles were there to buy, they don't have the money to invest at the moment. We also feel it's unfair that the rollout of the LEZs were not synchronised in Scotland across the four major cities. Glasgow starting early, June 23, compared to mid-24 for Dundee, Edinburgh and Aberdeen. They should have been synchronised, we feel, by the Scottish Government, not to discriminate against the city of Glasgow. So we would really need extra funding. That's always welcome, but we also need time to recover and time to get through this cost of living crisis. We also need to see the electric taxi market mature, as well as charging infrastructure appearing on the streets and the capacity that we need. We feel it would be a much better situation where we transition to electric vehicles in one step, rather than go down the retrofitting route. It would allow also the ambitions of net zero to be met, and that one transition, and probably in the long term, be a much better strategy.
Thank you. Mr. McLean and Mr. Fleming, would you like to address the question?
Yeah, thank you. So it's Robert McLean here from predominantly Glasgow Taxis Limited, but currently the Treasurer of the Scottish Taxi Federation. So building on what Stephen has just said there from Unite, there are a few points I would pick up on. First of all, the second-hand market, the availability of vehicles for fleet owners is at a stage where it's pretty limited in regards to what we can actually buy. So over the last few years, a company called Cab Direct, predominantly Allied in Glasgow, were able to produce a vehicle which was manufactured in Glasgow, in so much as it was converted, in Glasgow. It was either based on a Peugeot at one time, and then more latterly on a Ford Transit-type vehicle, a Tourneo, which they then converted into a six-seater wheelchair-accessible vehicle, which was utilised by the taxi trade. But come the advent of the Euro 6 necessity for the low-emission zone, They've stopped producing any vehicle, although the Transit was a Euro 6 vehicle. They've stopped producing that. They were unable to get the donor vehicles from Ford to be able to continue with that. The other vehicle we had a chance to use was the Mercedes Vito, again, a diesel Euro 6 compliant vehicle, but again, now in very short supply. And over the last couple of months, we've moved away from the automatic vehicle to a manual vehicle with a 1.7-litre engine, a diesel engine, probably still chipped in such a way that it's powerful. But, you know, Glasgow's got some fairly steep hills, if you think of in Slough Street, North Hanover, places like that. You know, it's a fair old task to take four or five people, or indeed six, as these vehicles can carry, in a situation like that. So we're fairly restricted in the availability of that type of vehicle. The next one that is available and probably what will become the main vehicle will be the LEVC, which is a hybrid-type vehicle, currently priced at £64,500 to us as the owner, and that's with a £7,500 UK grant taken off it. So you can see it's over £70,000 in its original iteration. So it's expensive to buy, and the only support available for that vehicle is the Energy Savings Trust interest-free loan, which over 6 years works out to £888 per month. So I'm sure most people would appreciate that's a fair old chunk of money. And yeah, in theory, you don't really have any fuel costs, but we all know electricity is increasing in price, and charging it at home, you'll certainly have to pay for it. And most street-side chargers now have some sort of a fee. And indeed, if you go away from the conurbations of Glasgow, Edinburgh and the bigger cities, then you find that it can be as much as 80 pence per kilowatt for a charge in some of the BP and some of these types of places that are now starting to see it as a revenue stream in place of the carbon fuels that they've traditionally supplied us all with over the last 100 years or so. So to that end, if there was support in relation to the LEVC or the Euro 6 vehicle available, that would be a huge assistance. Now, at the moment, there are a number of vehicles being taken up from London, which are then capable of being converted. So the only issue I see with that, and the trade in general see with that, is that in London, the owner of that vehicle has been given £10,000 to decommission it from the London market so that the London market can then hit its targets for the ultra-low emission zone. And where we are is that these vehicles are shipped all over the UK, not just to Glasgow, but these vehicles that have had £10,000 of public money given to them, then arrive in Glasgow or Birmingham or wherever they go, and they're then converted either to an LPG-style vehicle or with what's now known as the retrofit exhaust change that makes it capable of hitting the mark for a Euro 6. And in Scotland, the Energy Savings Trust again support the payment of that, whereby if it's the retrofit exhaust, then there's somewhere in the region of £5,500-£6,000 available by way of the grant, and the owner of the vehicle pays £1,500 of their own money. And if it's an LPG, I think the last figure I saw was about £13,700 to do that, of which 12 and a bit is paid for by the Energy Savings Trust. So you can see we're at a stage there where over the UK, £25,000 to £35,000 has been given by way of grant to these vehicles. But they're still old vehicles. They're still 12, 13, 14 plate vehicles. So they're already, you know, well used in the London market, maybe done over 150,000 miles, maybe more than that by the time they arrive in these other cities where they're going to then be converted and expect to get some sort of life out of them over another 10 to 15 years. I think that the public money would have been better spent to support, as I believe Manchester have done, a grant of £20,000 to an owner who's prepared to purchase the LEVC model. And as you can hear, £20,000 off of that 64 top price would be a good reduction in that, and you know, back down where the market was with the Mercedes and the Ford at around the £40,000 mark. So there's a number of things there can be done. The trade's in a really difficult position at the moment, not least because of probably some of the impacts of the pandemic and the absolute dearth of drivers. Now, I realise that all across, I'm just back from America, and even there are people crying out for workers in the hospitality industry, and I know that's absolutely the case all across Scotland. And we are very closely aligned to the hospitality industry. We work closely with events, floating events, you know, the hydro, large numbers of people coming and going to those concerts. All the hotel trade, we enjoy a very good relationship with nearly all the big hotels in Glasgow, whereby we're the provider of transport for them. And it's so disappointing when you let those type of customers down, because we simply don't have enough cars on the road in the evenings and nighttime economy in particular, and we only don't have enough cars because we don't have enough people to drive them. The cars are available, but we don't have the drivers to drive them. So I realise that's a slightly different topic, but it does have that impact on the whole trade as it stands at the moment. And so there's a number of factors there whereby the trade needs support to get drivers in. As a company, Glasgow Taxis have just run a four-week advert on STV to try and highlight the attractiveness of the flexibility of being either a taxi driver or a taxi owner and operator, and the potential that's there for people to come into a good job. And it is a good job, you know, there is a living to be made. But having come out of the pandemic, now into this current economic crisis, cost of fuel, road fuel, the cost of fuel for utilities at home, and as I say, the potential to charge an electric vehicle on the back of that, there's a number of factors there that are concerning. And my last point on it is it's an ageing trade. So we're all, or predominantly we're in our 60s, late 50s. I think the average age in Glasgow taxis as an owner is 59, and the average age of a driver is 54. So it is an ageing trade, and there are less and less people coming into it from any youth market. So to that end, someone who's going to invest £64,000 over 6 years, aged anything over 60, it's a huge consideration, not least of which because a lot of the guys don't have health insurance. None of us know where our health's going. So you know, there's a lot of factors there. There's a lot of worry. There's a lot of anxiety. And there are a lot of serious considerations around that economic part. So I'll close there, sir, and pass over to Murray Fleming, who just might want to add a couple of pointers, predominantly from the east side of the country. Thanks.
Mr. Fleming, thank you. I mean, Mr. McLean, that was very comprehensive, and you've touched on a number of issues there that I think we do want to explore. Mr. Fleming, would you like to add anything further to the comments from Mr. McLean?
No, I think Robert's covered most of the aspects. What I would say is that, you know, with the low emission zone expectations on the back of COVID and the capital investment required, if the Scottish Government wished to retain wheelchair accessible vehicles in the manner that we've become accustomed in Edinburgh and Glasgow, that is going to require funding. I also share the view that the funding towards LPG and the retrofits is misguided. I think investment in new vehicles would be a far better course of action.
Okay, thank you. I mean, I worry a little when you say it's a horribly old profession at 54 and 59. I'm 63, so I don't quite know what that says about my prospects. But thank you. I mean, I think there were three very specific areas there. We've got some areas of questioning we want to address, but I hope during the course of the evidence session we'll ensure that we do justice to all of those. Mr. Sweeney.
Thank you, Convener. I'll just preface my comments as a declaration of interest as a member of the Unite Trade Union. And I recognise a lot of the points that have been made as a member representing Glasgow, and particularly this controversy over the low emission zone restrictions planned for introduction next year. I understand that Glasgow City Council recently announced that enforcement on the LEZ will not apply to certain taxis until the 1st of June 2024, so effectively an extension of 1 year. Is this a sufficient time to allow non-compliant vehicles to be retrofitted with emissions reduction systems or indeed fully replaced?
And I don't know, I mean, Mr. Grant, how are we going to know when he wants to? Mr. Grant, can I come to you first? Would you like to comment on that?
Yeah, absolutely. Really, it's not enough time, a year's extension. The vehicles that are being talked about there are Euro 4 vehicles that don't have a retrofit solution or less than Euro 4. So these are the TX1, TX2 models, the Peugeot E7s and Mercedes Vitos that are not suitable for retrofitting, don't have a retrofit solution. Those vehicles will get a year's extension. Any that do have a retrofit solution will have to be done by June 23. Even the date of mid-24 is going to be a serious ask, as it is. And we just feel that then there needs to be a rethink, just like what's happened in Manchester, where the mayor of Manchester realised that the plans agreed pre-pandemic had to change because it would not work after the pandemic. So there really needs to be a rethink,
okay,
in my eyes and our union's eyes, that this is just not workable in its present form.
Mr. McLean, I mean, I'm going to assume from the contribution you made a moment ago that you take a similar view. Do you want to just articulate that? Either Mr. McLean or Mr. Fleming?
Yeah, sorry, I was waiting on the microphone. It's predominantly an issue with the retrofit equipment as well. The primary supplier of that is a company called Cybrand, who allow third-party engineers to install that equipment in the vehicles in Glasgow, and presumably when it comes to it in Edinburgh. I can speak for the Glasgow market because that's actively ongoing, but it's not actively ongoing because it's proven very difficult to get the kit from the Cybrand company. So they can provide the hardcore engineering part of it that converts the exhaust, but the Energy Savings Trust insists that along with that piece of hardware is a piece of software called telematics, or a black box, as the insurance companies call it, so that the movement of the vehicle can be monitored by Energy Savings Trust to ensure that A, it's still being used as a taxi, and B, that they know that it's fully operational and what they funded through that grant money. So the telematics aspect of it are proving impossible to get at the moment, and therefore Cybrand are unable at the moment to fit quite a number of vehicles. So that's proven difficult and challenging at this time. So that has the effect in rolling and kicking everything down the road, whereby the vehicles that are currently in the process of being funded by EST are not going to get their equipment installed into their vehicles for some considerable time. And so that's going to have a knock-on effect on all the other operators and owners who are trying to hit the mark. In Glasgow, they have to be registered by next Monday, the 31st of October. They have to have declared that either we're going to go ahead with a retrofit or an LPG solution, excuse me, or a new vehicle purchase. And as I've explained earlier, the availability of new vehicles is now probably at the LEVC only. There are only two dealers in Scotland, one in Edinburgh, one just newly started in Glasgow as recently as 2 weeks ago. So you can see the challenges that the trade has faced, not just through the pandemic and as a result of the pandemic, but for all that period of 2 years, the ability to buy vehicles or have availability of vehicles has proved a real challenge. Okay. Thanks.
Sorry, Mr. Grant, I understand you would like to add just something further.
It is the case that there's a significant number of vehicles that do have retrofit solutions, but that's only on paper. A lot of these vehicles will be structurally compromised long before the actual retrofit technologies ended its life cycle. So what you're looking at as well is that there is a lot of operators scrambling about to change those retrofittable vehicles to a vehicle that's structurally sound, that will last for the life cycle of the retrofit, and these vehicles are not available because the used market's completely dysfunctional at the moment. The vehicles, the retrofit that we would say are structurally sound and will last the duration of the retrofit technology, are just not available.
Okay, thank you. Are we still on the subject, Mr. Sweeney? Are you going to move on? Because I have a question I'd like to ask on this aspect, unless you have another.
No, feel free to carry on.
I
recognise, you know, you've described, you know, significant constraints, age profile, the financial crunch that's involved, you know, the risks associated with people reaching the end of their careers, having to take on a huge amount of leverage financially. I know that the Scottish Government, in response to a written question I tabled some months ago, indicated the three main schemes that the Energy Saving Trust are administering on their behalf, the switched on taxi loan scheme, interest-free loan up to 120,000. I think there was a response that mentioned the servicing costs are about 800,000 a month. But there was also the low emission zone retrofit fund, which provided 80% grant funding to replace existing diesel engines to meet the Euro 6 standard for driving within an LEZ. The grant provides up to £10,000 per wheelchair accessible taxi installing repowering technology, or £5,000 per taxi installing exhaust after treatment systems. The low emission zone support fund, which is available to eligible micro businesses and sole traders, including taxi operators, which provides a £2,500 grant towards safe disposal of non-compliant vehicles as an incentive. That was a response to a written question tabled on the 6th of January. Just you mentioned the Manchester scheme was a £20,000 grant, so I just wonder, in the context of those three options that are provided by the Scottish Government, are you suggesting that something along the lines of the retrofit fund, if it was enhanced to provide the grant towards new purchases, could be a satisfactory solution to all of this?
Mr. McLean, I'll come to you first because you raised this specifically.
Yeah, I think that's a very valid point, Mr. Sweeney. As I said in my initial presentation there, the current use of the public money with regards to where it is being spent, you talk about the £2,000 there for the scrappage scheme. If an owner or operator takes advantage of that £2,000 and then they have to buy a new vehicle, so that's fine, it only has to be a year newer, and then it hits the mark to have some other retrofit solution added, that £2,000 is then deducted from any subsequent grant that would be paid in relation to that. So if you take a vehicle that gets £2,000 and it gets scrapped or taken off the road in Glasgow, and then they go and get a retrofit exhaust fitted to a newer vehicle, that £5,000 grant would be reduced by the £2,000, so that £5,000 is still the maximum that they're getting to put a newer vehicle on the road that hits the mark for the Glasgow low emission zone compliance. So the LPG conversion, as you said, is the 80% part, which I'd say at the moment I think is running about just over £12,000 that will be grant funded by the Energy Savings Trust, the balance being paid by the owner. But that's a complete repowering solution. That's removing the diesel engine from the old taxi, putting in, I believe, a fairly decent petrol engine, and then the parts that go with the exhaust to make it comply with the correct Euro 6 compliance in relation to the use of that LPG powering. So it starts on petrol, converts itself to LPG once it's running, and runs on LPG. As you may also be aware, for about a month there, sourcing LPG proved particularly challenging in Glasgow. I'm not sure about Edinburgh, but we had guys running to Kilmarnock and Hamilton to try and source LPG. So I'm fairly sure you can imagine that by the time they got back, their availability of fuel to operate in Glasgow was significantly reduced. So a real number of issues and challenges around about this whole retrofitting of old vehicles, whether it's repowering or retrofitting exhausts. And by far, the best solution is to make available a decent funded solution that allows people to get into a market where they can buy not necessarily a new vehicle. You know, for instance, I've got a two-year-old Mercedes, fully compliant vehicle, but if I was getting a grant to buy a new vehicle, I would buy a new vehicle and make my vehicle available in that second-hand market, whereby somebody who's got an even older vehicle could take advantage of that, my second-hand vehicle, at a much better price, and see Glasgow hit the mark for fully compliant. The last thing we want is to lose the fleet in Glasgow, and none of us are against the low emission zone. Everyone fully supports the health aspects and absolutely everything that's trying to be done. But Glasgow, as a city, just can't lose the fleet overnight, which, you know, it won't lose the fleet in 1st of June, but it'll lose a huge part of it, and that's a real worry.
Okay. Thank you. Mr. Sweeney, I'll come back to you. Does that lead you into your next question?
You know, you seem to have a clear set of asks, and I just wondered if you had presented a counter-proposal in the case of Glasgow City Council, and if that had been well received, or if they've just kind of ignored what you've been trying to say about a reasonable set of countermeasures to clearly what is quite a blunt instrument that's already seen a 20%, I think, reduction in the number of licences in the city.
And I'll come to both groups, but that was actually the kind of area I was going to explore too, because I did want to ask who within Glasgow City Council, what sort of reception you felt you were having to the exploration of the arguments that you are making, because I'm clear you've made some quite comprehensive but technical both specification arguments in relation to the availability of vehicles, but also to the financial construction that would be available to support the alternatives that you think would be best. I say that as someone who spent 25 years in the Scottish retail motor industry and myself found from time to time that the technical specifications which were real, the difficulties and practicalities associated with that weren't always understood by policymakers who were keen to drive forward to a particular objective. And so I'm interested to know, as Mr. Sweeney is, just who and how you feel those discussions are with whom they're taking place and how you feel these arguments are being received. So I'll come to both. Mr. Grant, you might want to come in on that and also touch on the previous question.
From Glasgow City Council, councillors such as Anna Richardson, who's no longer in position, and also Angus Miller, they're the main people that we've been discussing our counter-proposals with, but I'm afraid it's fallen on deaf ears, and come hell or high water, they want to implement the LEZ in June 23, despite all our protestations and all our concerns. It does seem to be falling on deaf ears.
And given that, just to explore that point, given that you are detailing quite specific technical and availability issues around actually being able to comply, what sort of response is there to that reality?
It seems like they particularly don't want to understand the issues we're having. As I said, they're wanting to push ahead with this. There has been the mitigation of allowing those with older vehicles that don't have the retrofit solution, the extra year, but really it's just tinkering around the edges. We've explained that, you know, the issues what I raised earlier about retrofitting vehicles that have a solution on paper. Really, these vehicles don't justify the retrofit. They won't last the duration of the retrofit technology. So these people are having to go out and purchase vehicles if they can get them anyway. So they're in the same position as that person that doesn't have a retrofit solution. But as I said, I can only say that for the numerous meetings that we've had with Angus Miller, John Molyneux, Green Councillor, we just feel that they're not listening, and come hell or high water, this is going through.
Mr. McLean and Mr. Fleming, would you like to comment on Mr. Sweeney's question and my codicil?
Yeah, indeed. There's a number of issues there, particularly in relation to Glasgow, first of all, and I'll let Murray give a quick update on the Edinburgh side after. Before COVID even happened, if you go back to late 2019, as a committee, as a company, we compiled a presentation which we called Death by a Thousand Cuts, which was where we saw the taxi trade would suffer within the next 10 years to such an extent that we would probably be left with no trade in Glasgow. That's all the things I mentioned earlier about drivers, age of vehicles, etc., etc. And we presented that initially to a couple of councillors, the licensing department, a number of key stakeholders in the Glasgow City Council. Along came COVID, and things changed significantly. We continued to make those presentations and culminated and been able to make the presentation to Susan Aiken, the leader of the council in Glasgow. Along came May last year, the elections came and went, Susan was back in and her team were back in. Anna Richardson, who was very, very keen to listen, but certainly very stuck in her ways in relation to how she saw that low emission zone and where it was going to go. She was replaced by Angus Miller, and we get an audience with Mr. Miller, we speak to him, we give him the presentation, and all the while, Glasgow are hell-bent on making sure that this goes ahead on the date that they've always said it would go ahead. They're clearly eager to please the Scottish Government in so much as they want to hit those marks whereby Glasgow are first to do it. They want to be seen to be hitting the marks in relation to the 2030 energy efficiency figures as laid down by the Scottish Government, whereby we stop selling any internal combustion engines by then, et cetera, et cetera. I mean, that in itself would be all fantastic, but the vehicle I spoke about at £64,000, as I said, was a hybrid, but still has a petrol engine in it. We invest £64,000, is there a guarantee anywhere that at some point Glasgow won't look to become zero emission rather than low emission? So all these things are factors in the background. Glasgow City Council will listen. They won't necessarily act on what they hear, but you get an audience, you'll get a chance to speak, you'll get a chance to have your say, but they'll continue in exactly what they're doing.
Mr. Fleming, do you want to add anything in relation to Edinburgh?
Well, in relation to Edinburgh, we do have a deadline of you know, the 2024 deadline, which is helpful. What's important to note as well, that Edinburgh has an age limit as well. So not only does it have to be Euro 6, it has to be 10 years or less. So we've got vehicles in Edinburgh that guys are taking the Cybrand product, converting their vehicle, and it only has one year's extension in effect. We are seeking to get that extended to 14 years. LPG vehicles are extended to 14 years, which seems rather unfair when you could have a Mercedes Euro 6 that will have to go off the road after 10 years. But, you know, we've accepted the policy, but I think councils are adopting the approach that this is government policy. We simply have no scope for change. And, you know, that is the deadline, come what may. But as these, a lot of people in the trade, they've got these older vehicles. Once they get to that 2024 deadline, they're walking away. And there's no one to replace them, no one to be prepared to take the funding on board.
Thank you very much. Mr. Sweeney, do you want to say more? Well, I can move on to Mr. Torrens.
Just to say thanks for that insight. It does seem that the financial solution sits with the Scottish Government in terms of the Energy Saving Trust products that are offered via the Government. So perhaps if we're able to sort of present a counter-proposal to the Government as well, that could potentially be a way of dealing with the intransigence you're experiencing at a council level. You know, it seems like there isn't much appetite for moving any further in terms of the deadlines. But, you know, in terms of that financial remedy that Manchester's reached, perhaps there could be a similar remedy here. Would that be something that we could perhaps look at taking forward?
And Mr. Torrance, that leads in, I think, to your kind of general question.
Yes, thank you very much, Convener. And good morning to all the witnesses. In written evidence, the Scottish Taxi Federation argues that the current taxi and driver licensing regime under a Civic Government Scotland Act 1982 is no longer fit for purpose. Why do you think this, and how best could the system be brought to date? And just to let you know, I was on the regular licensing board for 20 years at Fife Council. OK? And that seemed Murray and Robert.
Mr. McLean, do you want to... Mr. Fleming, do you want
Clearly, the Act, as the name suggests, was introduced in 1982. So here we are all these years later, 50 years later, looking at an Act that's... 40 years later, looking at an Act that's got a bit of catching up to do, particularly in relation to technology. When that Act was written, it was all very traditional in that a private hire car was a private hire car simply because it wasn't a taxi. And what is a taxi? A taxi is a vehicle that can pick up in the street. It can sit at a rank and take people from a rank. It can also take called-for cabs, called-for hires, like a private hire car, but a private hire car cannot do shouldn't do the aspects that are referred to by picking up in the street or picking up at a rank. Along come mobile phones and things start to change a little bit. People no longer have to go to the what in London they call the minicab office, or up here, the private hire car operator's office, to await the arrival of a private hire car. And likewise, people don't have to go to the phone box or stand in the street and traditionally hail the cab in the street. They look for the orange light, they hail the cab, and along comes a mobile phone so they can phone the company. That changes things significantly. But lo and behold, the mobile phone becomes a smartphone, and all of a sudden we have apps, things that those of us born in the 50s had never had any knowledge of, and some still have no knowledge of, particularly in our trade. They're very reticent to change and acknowledge those changes. But we have apps, and along come disruptors into that app technology. We are not transport providers, they're technologists. So along come a company called Uber, who are probably the biggest disruptor in this market in Glasgow and Edinburgh. Uber arrive with a very slick app. There are millions, hundreds of millions of pounds to waste and throw and lose at a trade that still has never made them a penny of profit. And so we try to emulate that. And as recently as last month in Glasgow, we tried to put in place a fixed pricing structure. As a result of some work that we've done through Scott Pulse, a national survey company, and we surveyed the people of Glasgow to say, what would you like to see in your local cab company, public hire cab company? And they said, oh, we'd love to see that meter being taken away because that causes real anxiety And I don't know if you've ever sat in the back of a black cab when it's stuck in traffic coming from Ibrox and there's a meeting on it or an event on at the Hydro, and you come to the squinty bridge and you can sit for maybe 20, 25 minutes before you eventually get over that bridge, and that meter's ticking and ticking and ticking, and the poor customer on the back sitting looking at it saying, am I going to have to pay that? Now, the reasonable drivers will say, look, don't worry about the meter, pal, we'll get that sorted once we get to central station or wherever we're going. But less scrupulous drivers might just leave the meter running and charge that person exactly what that meter says, as I'm entitled to do. So all these things have created a real issue in relation to how we operate those taxis. As you know, in the city, we have to operate every hire on the meter. The meter must be engaged. And the fixed price was never going to be an option at this particular time, certainly not until the 82 Act either gets an upgrade and recognises technology, or in some other way sees that there has been some changes, significant changes, in relation to how the trade operates over these last 40 years and tries and hauls itself into the 21st century to fit and sit exactly where we are now in relation to those aspects.
Mr. Fleming?
No, I concur with Robert's thoughts there. And coming back to the meter is there to protect the public. What's the first thing these companies do is ensure they don't have a meter, which allows for escalation of fares when it's busy. So the black cab trade, very often now at busy weekends, see themselves at a disadvantage, earning less than a sector that has far less capital investment. As I come back to the thing that if you want a wheelchair-accessible fleet, there has to be some form of assistance offered.
Okay, thank you. I'm not sure all of the committee would specifically have experienced that coming from Ibrox, but I'm sure we have all sat in a cab with a meter running. Mr. Grant.
Murray made there. We also have big issues in Glasgow with satellite council areas, licensing private hire vehicles, and working within Glasgow City almost exclusively. We see that with particularly with South Lanarkshire vehicles now working the west end of Glasgow and contravening the Civic Government Scotland Act 1982. It's a huge problem. There should be some sort of geofencing there to stop them doing this. But yeah, there needs to be an update in terms of of geofencing areas, as far as I'm concerned.
Mr. Stewart.
Thank you, convener. And gentlemen, thank you very much for your comprehensive comments this morning. You have identified, there's no question, that this is an industry that is in crisis. And without the proper support and the proper mechanisms that will be in place, that you will find the demise of some of that. And we've already seen the reductions that came through the pandemic, and you've talked eloquently about the demographics and the age situation. So when it comes to the Scottish Government, they have to give you support mechanisms. And we've touched on some of the grants and we've touched on some of the areas that have already been proposed. But do you believe that there's room for more incentives to ensure that you can be supported as a sector? Because if these grants are not sufficient, and they are not equivalent to what's happening elsewhere, then you will be at a disadvantage from other locations across the United Kingdom. And the Scottish Government have a role and responsibility to act to support you. So it would be good to hear what you think could be done more by the Scottish Government and what they should be looking at, maybe outside the box, to try and support you as to what is required. Because, as I said earlier, and you've identified, if this does not take place sooner rather than later, then there will be sections of the community that no longer have the support mechanisms for taxis that they've enjoyed in the past.
Thank you. An invitation for a wish list there, gentlemen. Mr. Grant, can I come to you first? And we are slightly short of time now, so if I could ask everybody to be a little bit concise.
Well, one thing that we did ask for is to have a dedicated taxi team within Transport Scotland. They don't currently have that. The buses do. And, for example, if you look at the disparity in the grant offerings for buses compared to taxis, the buses have been given somewhere around 40 to 50% grants to change from diesel buses to electric buses. If you look at what's available for taxis at the moment, there is a scrappage scheme that you get £2,000 for scrapping your old vehicle. If you put that against the £65,000 cost of an electric vehicle, it comes in at around 4% grant. So that's a tenfold difference between the buses and the taxis. And I have to think that that's possibly because there's little understanding of the taxi trade, and a dedicated team within Transport Scotland would obviously help enormously.
OK, thank you. Mr McLean and Mr Fleming, and again, if I could ask you to be quite brief now, thank you.
Yeah, indeed. I think the points I outlined earlier probably cover it, sir, in relation to better use of what public money is available. Of course, if there is more can be made available, and I think we all understand entirely the current economic crisis is ongoing and the number of demands being placed on the resources of the Scottish Government and indeed local councils. But I think if people recognise that to purchase a wheelchair accessible vehicle, a black car, whatever you want to call it, is a significant investment. And it's a significant investment, not just for the owner and operator, for the city, for the people who rely on that. We're trying to reduce the number of cars that come into and frequent those city centres. So let's make better use of the cars we are going to allow in, the private hire, the black cabs, the companies that are going to provide the transport for people and ensure that people still have that freedom of movement to enjoy those cities, go to events, shopping, eating, whatever it is they're doing. But let's make sure we have a fleet that's commensurate with what the cities want, what the Scottish Government presumably want, to ensure that those wheelchair accessible vehicles are available and that there's a funding support there that will ensure that as a trade we can maintain that. Thanks.
Mr Fleming?
Just a more targeted approach to funding of new and suitable second-hand vehicles that have a reasonable lifespan left, you know, within their operation. Stop wasting money on some of these retrofits that are throwing money at old vehicles that are not, and they're not suitable from the outset, in our opinion.
Mr Ewing?
Yes, good morning, gentlemen. I wanted to ask about the engagement you've had with the Scottish Government. The Scottish Government told this committee in August last year, more than a year ago, and I quote, officials will make contact with the petitioner to discuss engagement between Transport Scotland and the taxi sector. Can I ask what the outcome of these discussions was, please?
Mr Grant.
A meeting with Jenny Gilruth and just laid out the issues that we were facing. And all that really came out of that was a modest increase in the grants towards the retrofit. Nothing else really that was groundbreaking. We were calling for them to put the brakes on the timeline. It's just far too soon considering everything that's happened.
Yep.
But they don't seem to want to put a pause on it. And Jenny Gilruth was at pains to suggest that Glasgow City Council had it within their gift to delay the enforcement date of June 23 for us, and basically washed their hands of the issue.
Could I ask when that meeting took place, the meeting with the Transport Minister?
I can't give you an exact date, but it's roughly around 2 to 3 months ago.
Okay. I also wanted to ask if all of the witnesses could, perhaps after this meeting, convener, send us some of the detail of the points they've made, because I suspect I'm not alone that you have made out a pretty strong set of arguments, and the figures that you've mentioned I would like to study in a bit more detail and see them in black and white, because it does seem to me that you are the Cinderella of the public transport sector, the way that you've been treated, because you're trying to do the right thing, but you're being told you must do the right thing by the state, and the state therefore must have a greater responsibility to assist you to do that without forcing your members out of business or imposing an unreasonable financial burden, as you have described today, and I think persuaded me that you've made a stateable case. But I would like to see the figures in writing, and therefore I would make that request, and specifically if you could share with us details of the Manchester alternative and how they do it there, because I think the earlier on in the evidence I can't remember who it was, but one of you said that in Manchester they do provide a more generous scheme to enable assistance by way of grant finance or purchase of a new vehicle, rather than, as you've argued, kind of throw money away at retrofitting old vehicles that are ready, more or less, to go to that great car cemetery in the sky. So that's just the request I make, because if you do that, then I think this committee may well want to try to see how we can help you advance this, and time, of course, is again you, so it would have to be done quite quickly. I hope, Convener, that's a reasonable request.
Just before any of the witnesses come back in, I'll just ask Mr Sweeney wants to come in on the same point, I think.
Yeah, it was just a supplementary to Mr Ewing's call for some more evidence or some more helpful information. You mentioned the wider impacts on the economy. I can, you know, attest to, anecdotally in Glasgow, significant issues being felt by businesses, nighttime economy, not getting the sort of trade that they used to get because people are basically saying it's too difficult to get back home from Glasgow. Therefore, the city is like in a ghost town at night. Also, you know, massive queues at ranks coming off of train stations. You're waiting about half an hour for a cab out of George Square sometimes, and that's midweek. But also, big events like the SEC, you know, they're feeling that as well in ticket sales. And you mentioned the manufacturing base. You know, we had a healthy ecosystem in Glasgow, manufacturing taxis at Allied Vehicles in Postle Park, employing over 600 people in skilled manufacturing. You mentioned the only product available potentially is a Coventry and Shanghai-based manufacturer, LEVC. There's a wider economic impact here, both in terms of the supply chain of taxis in Scotland and the impact on the nighttime economy in major cities like Glasgow. If there's any more evidence you could help furnish us with, whether Unite could commission that or whether we can try and find ways of building that picture up, I think it would add more, a more compelling argument to this. Yeah.
I'm concerned we are kind of almost out of time. So what I'd like to suggest is that the clerks will liaise with our witnesses this morning on some of the areas where it might be helpful to get more detailed evidence and information. And I'm sure you would all be very happy to cooperate with that. I've got, and I'll allow you to come in and confirm that in a second, but I just wanted one final question was something Mr. McLean touched on. We did ask all local authorities earlier what the effect of the pandemic had been, and about half of local authorities responded, and the general response was there had been, in the wake of the pandemic, a sort of 20% reduction in the number of available cabs across those local authorities. Anecdotally, I've heard in my own local authority there's been a little bit of a recovery from that. But I did hear Mr. McLean say, we've got the cars, we don't have the drivers. And one of the suggestions that was made to me is that some local authorities are at the moment under-resourced in terms of actually processing applications from drivers who might be interested. So I'm interested just to know, finally, along with confirmation that you would be happy to provide further information, when you say that you have the cars but not the drivers, is it a question of the attractiveness of the proposition? Is it a question of the time it's taking for people who might want to enter into the profession to actually get a licence? Mr. McLean?
Yeah, so a couple of points there, and I'll be as quick as I can. One, in the public hire trade, you have to have the topographical test, what London calls the knowledge, in addition to the new Scottish Qualification Authority Certificate of Professional Taxi Driver. So there are these two hurdles to pass over before you can then even apply to become a taxi driver. And as part of our presentation for the Death by a Thousand Cuts, Susan Aitken had agreed that there probably was something Glasgow City Council could do by removing the topographical initially and allowing, as we suggested, to make it a kind of an apprentice for a year, whereby you could drive a taxi, because let's face it, lots of people use sat-nav now or mobile phones to navigate. And at that point, you can learn your way around the city and then sit the exam, probably with a much higher chance of passing it and being of more use in the trade anyway. When she went back to the licensing and regulatory committee with that was thrown out. So we are where we are. We still have the topo, we still have the SQA, and we still have to jump those fences and hoops to achieve getting a driver into a taxi. To touch on a previous point, just very quickly, the STF, Scottish Taxi Federation, have had no communication with any Scottish minister or Scottish government, other than I attend two short-life working groups. where the EST attend, though predominantly Derek McCready is the person from the Energy Savings Trust. So I speak regularly to Derek, but no one at any higher or finance level. That covers that. Thanks.
Okay, thank you. And Mr. Grant, finally, on behalf of the petitioner, as you're speaking today, any final comments you'd like to make?
Just to say, that to me it does seem that Glasgow City Council, at least our licensing, are under-resourced. We can wait up to a year and a half to get a physical driver licence badge out to the driver. Similar with the operator's licence, the taxi licence, it's taken up to a year to get that out. There does seem to be a staff shortage in there dealing with licensing applications. But I also think that there's been a lot of reflection through the pandemic from drivers who have now left the trade looking for a better work-life balance, because there was an oversupply of vehicles and it made it very difficult to make a living unless you put in serious hours. So a lot of jumped now that there is a demand for drivers in other sectors.
Okay, thank you for that. And gentlemen, thank you all. I think the committee has very much appreciated the evidence you've given. It certainly has, I think, justified our decision to have this slight roundtable discussion this morning. There are a number of issues that we wish to pursue, and we look forward to your further assistance with us as we do that. Thank you all very much, and I'll suspend for a few moments. Thank you. Welcome back, and we now move on with the continuation of item one, which is consideration of continuing petitions. Petition number 1854, review the adult disability payment eligibility criteria for people with motability needs, lodged by Keith Park, calling on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to remove the 20-metre rule from the proposed adult disability payment eligibility criteria, or to identify an alternative form of support for people with motability needs. The committee agreed at its last consideration to ask the Scottish Government to engage with stakeholders on the review of adult disability payment. And the Scottish Government has now confirmed that engagement with relevant stakeholders will be included in the remit for both stages of the ADP review. We also have a further written submission from the petitioner calling on the committee to seek further evidence from stakeholders and report directly to the review. We're joined this morning by our colleague Carol Mockin. Carol, good morning. Welcome. Thank you for your patience. Would you like to contribute to the committee's thinking on the issue?
Thank you very much for asking me to speak, and I very much appreciate the opportunity. As you've said, want to speak to petition 1854. As you know, the petitioners have asked the committee to continue to seek evidence with a view to producing a report to submit to the 2020 review on moving around descriptors within adult disability payment. So I think it's fair just to give a little bit of background to the 20-metre rule. The 20-metre rule was introduced as part of the eligibility criteria to access personal independence payment, and it means if you can walk one step over 20 metres, you do not qualify for the enhanced rate of mobility support. The rule does not consider the nature of fluctuating conditions or the impact of physical or mental fatigue. And it does not make allowances for people who perhaps have further distances that they require to go, and they may have to stop and start on those distances. The relevant point here is that the Scottish Government are replacing PIP with the adult disability payment, the ADP, but they are keeping the eligibility criteria the same. And I know that the petitioner has tried to lobby the government on this and continues to do. So I have spoken with a number of people who have been affected by this rule, and in particular people suffering from MS, and it greatly affects that group of people. And I've spoken to individuals and to the organisation. And since introducing the rule, the MS Society has done some research, and the findings, I think, are very relevant for the committee, that one in three people with MS have had their support downgraded. 2% of people with MS had actually to give up work altogether because they lost that enhanced rate of mobility support. They needed that support to continue with their work, which is really important for them as individuals, but of course for the economy as well. People should always be able to have that opportunity if they can. Around 611 people with MSF gave up work altogether just due to the loss of mobility, and that's between 2020 and 2022. And the Society believe, from speaking to people and the evidence that they've gathered, that this has cost the government, actually, in the way in which they support people with MS, due to the additional cost to the NHS and to the rise in claims and other income supports. So when on speaking to the Society, I felt their points were very, very relevant and important. But what difference can the committee make by keeping this petition open? Well, I think one of the considerations is that this committee is about engaging people and making sure that underrepresented voices are heard and gives them a platform. And so the petitioner feels that this petition staying open would certainly offer that opportunity, certainly up until the report or the moving about report is finalised. They also feel that people at the sharp end of the 20-metre rule want to be able to engage in a meaningful debate and continue that debate. And they're a very marginalised group due to their disability, and they do find it difficult to find avenues in to participate in the discussions and debates. And this petitions committee has certainly allowed them to do that, and they would wish them to continue. You've already had evidence, so you could continue that relatively well. And that the MS Society feel that the government are quite open to some of the evidence that you are collecting, and so it would be relevant at that time. And I think, the last point is that it does seem premature when the evidence has been supportive. The Society have felt this has been a very successful route for them and their members, and we would hope that you would consider keeping it open at least until that review is made.
Thank you very much for that, Carol Malkin. This is an important petition, and we have, I think, considered it in some detail. I think that the Scottish Government have confirmed that they will include stakeholders in the review, and so I certainly would like to propose we keep the petition open at the present time. I wonder if colleagues would be happy for us to write to the Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice, Housing and Local Government just to request information in more detail on the timescales and the completed dates for each stage of this review, to ask how the government intends to report on the stage one of the review, so we have an understanding of the thinking, and to ask how the Scottish Government intends to engage with the Scottish Parliament throughout the period of the review and on the proposals and recommendations for action. Are there any other proposals from the committee? Are we content to proceed on that basis, David Torrens?
I wholeheartedly agree with your recommendations here, but I think the committee should wait to take any further decision with the petition as well until we actually see that the first stage of the review before we bring it back to committee.
Yeah, Mr. Ewing.
Carol Malkin, MSP, has provided very interesting information about the impact on people who have MS. I just wonder, Convener, if it might be appropriate to write to the MS Society in order to elicit more information from them. Maybe Carol could help us with help the clerks with information she's got, but I think given what she's informed the committee of today, I would be interested to dig a bit deeper to see if there are, in fact, people who have been casualties of of this rule, if you like, and I've lost the ability to carry on working. That's a very serious matter, and I'm very grateful that Carol has brought that to the committee today. But I would be keen to see if the MS Society can add more a more complete picture.
No, I think that would be very helpful. Mr Park, who has lodged a petition on behalf of the MS Society, I think it would be interesting to drill down into the very specific complications arising from the condition itself. Mr Sweeney?
Just to say I concur with the comments you've made, Convener, and also from Ms Mockin, and a really important need to keep this open. I think that, you know, it's one thing having the government doing a review, but it's the role of Parliament to keep that government under scrutiny, and I think this committee performs an important function in that regard, and this is clearly a live item of business this committee has been attending to, and therefore we are well placed to perform that role. So I think even informing the lead committee that we intend to do this, it would be helpful as well.
Yeah. Are we all content? We are content. Thank you very much. We move on to petition number 1907, provide funded early learning and childcare for all two-year-olds in Scotland. A continuing petition lodged by Claire Beats, which calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to provide funded early learning and childcare for all two-year-olds, removing eligibility criteria for access to services. And we last considered this petition on the 23rd of March. We agreed to write to the Scottish Government for further information and on its plans to address concerns about the impact of COVID-19 on the development of children born during the pandemic periods. And we've received a response from the Scottish Government in which they refer to their commitment to expand early learning and childcare to 1 and 2 year olds, starting this Parliament with children from low-income households. That's me quoting from the response. And the response also states the Scottish Government are funding a range of learning resources for early learning practitioners, which are directly relevant to supporting COVID-19 recovery. Do members have any comments or suggestions? Mr Stewart.
Convener, I think once again this is a very live situation and circumstances, and I know the Scottish Government are, and in the responses they've given us, have indicated what they're trying to achieve. But I think it would be useful to get some further details of the anticipated timescales for expanding the early learning and childcare to the 1 and 2 year olds, because that will give us a more clarity as to where we stand at the present time, and that will give us an idea as to how we could progress things for the future.
That seems sensible, Mr Stewart. The committee agreed?
Yep.
We are, thank you. Petition number 1914, ban school uniforms in secondary schools, lodged by Matthew Lewis Simpson, which calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to remove the requirement for school uniforms in secondary schools, last considered by us on the 20th of April. And we agreed at that petition, at that meeting, to keep the petition open while writing to the Scottish Government following its publication on the consultation on school uniforms. We also agreed to write to the Scottish Government highlighting the evidence we've received and seek further information on how children and young people have been involved actually in the consultation process. Now, we've now received two responses from the Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills. These highlight the timing of the Scottish Government consultation on school uniforms, which ended on the 14th of October. And they also confirmed that the consultation process would include bespoke engagement with children and young people. At the same time, they also suggested that the Scottish Government doesn't intend to take a national uniform approach, a uniform approach to uniforms, and that there would be that local authority and education authorities would have a responsibility and determination in all of this as well. Do we have any suggestions? Mr. Torrens.
Considering that the consultation has been published and the Cabinet Secretary has indicated that there's no plans to abolish school uniform or mandate for specific school uniform, I don't think we could take this anywhere else. And under 15.7 of standing orders, I would like to close the petition.
Our colleagues agreed. Well, we'd thank the petitioner for raising the issue. The consultation has now been published. And as Mr Torrens says, I think that is, given the Scottish Government's response, the limit that the committee can go to, and so we were agree to close the petition. That brings us to agenda item 2, which is the consideration of new petitions, the first of which is petition number 1939 to amend the date of birth to allow wider accessibility to the HPV vaccination programme for boys. And this has been lodged by Suzanne Thornton, calling on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to demonstrate a commitment to health equality for young males born between September 1, 1997 and 1 September 2006 by allowing them to access the HPV vaccination via the NHS. Suzanne tells us she is concerned that the current vaccine eligibility criteria is creating a health inequality. She notes that all girls, as well as men, who have sex with men aged up to 45 years are offered the HPV vaccination, while young males born prior to September 2006 are unable to access the vaccine. Should a young male born prior to this date wish to receive the HPV vaccine, they would have to do so through private healthcare, which Suzanne advised would cost approximately £500. The Scottish Government notes in their response that eligibility for teenage immunisation programmes in Scotland are defined by academic year rather than date of birth. As such, any boy that started S1 in 2019-20 would have been offered the vaccine and will remain eligible up to his 25th birthday. The response from the Scottish Government also notes that the JCVI do not currently recommend a catch-up programme for boys, and state that the evidence suggests boys are already benefiting from indirect protection as a result of the rollout of the vaccination programme to girls. Now, the HPV vaccination programme has been a controversial one. I know it's been the subject of previous discussion in the Public Petitions Committee in earlier sessions. Do members have any comments or suggestions in relation to the petition we've received this morning? Mr. Stewart.
Convener, I think this is an area that does require a little bit more depth and clarity. So I would suggest that we write to the Joint Committee of Vaccination and Immunisation to ask if there are plans to review the need for and the value of the catch-up immunisation programme for males aged 25 years and younger, and also to write to Teenage Cancer Trust, to Joe Cervical Cancer Trust, Young Scot and Men's Mental Health Forum to seek their views on the issues raised by the petitioner. I think all of that would be of interest for us to clarify and to see what is required for the future.
Mr. Stewart, thank you. Are there any other organisations colleagues would suggest we contact, or are we content to keep the petition open and pursue further evidence from those sources? We are, I think. Thank you very much. So the petition will stay open and we will seek to gather further evidence to consider it at a later date. Petition number 1942, Encourage Peer Support Programmes in Public Sector Organisations, which has been lodged by Fiona McCrae, calling on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to promote the use of peer-supported programmes such as Trim and Straw in public sector workplaces to promote better mental health. Fiona tells us that the use of the Trauma Risk Management, Trim and Sustaining Reliance at Work Straw processes could help create psychological safety at work by encouraging employees to complete an incident report when they experience or witness behaviours that may affect the mental health of employees. Fiona also suggests early intervention could help reduce the number of employees experiencing mental health problems while contributing to a safer, more positive workplace culture. In responding to the aims of this petition, the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care has provided information on a range of actions being taken to promote mentally healthy workplaces. These include a mental health transition and recovery plan, funding for a national trauma training programme, and the establishment of a peer recovery hub by the Scottish Recovery Network. In view of this, members, do we have any suggestions or comments for further action? Mr. Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if we could keep the petition open to get more information, and the committee could write to relevant stakeholder organisations, including Mental Health Foundation, Scots Association for Mental Health, Samaritans, the Scottish Recovery Network and the Laura Hyde Foundation, seeking their views on the value of and the need for provision of peer support programmes in workplaces across Scotland.
Thank you, Mr. Torrance. Do any other colleagues wish to add to that? Are we content to keep the petition open and to write to the organisations as suggested by Mr. Torrance? I think we are. Thank you very much. We move then to petition number 1943, to help prevent the destruction of greenfield sites by providing financial incentives towards the remediation reuse of brownfield sites. This has been lodged by Victoria Mungall and calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to introduce financial support mechanisms which would enable local authorities to work alongside developers in bringing brownfield sites back into use while also discouraging developments on greenfield land. Victoria tells us that brownfield sites can often be difficult and expensive to remediate due to contamination, unstable ground and other challenges. And this results in greenfield sites being targeted for development, which can be far less expensive for developers to build upon. Victoria also highlights that in England, grants have been introduced which allow local authorities to contribute to the remediation of brownfield land. Now, in their response, the Scottish Government provide details of the Vacant and Derelict Land Investment Programme, which was launched in March 2021. This is a £50 million fund available on a competitive basis to all Scottish local authorities and to the Clyde Gateway Urban Regeneration Company. Members may also be aware that the Draft National Planning Framework, MPF4, proposed an updated and expanded on policy on vacant and derelict land, which discourages development on greenfield land unless no suitable brownfield alternatives are available. Once again, can I ask if members have any thoughts or comments? Mr. Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I think the committee should keep the petition open until the fourth national planning framework is finalised and approved, so we could look at it to see the updated version of it. And in doing so, can we also write to the Royal Town Planning Institute, Homes for Scotland, and COSLA seeking their views on the issues raised in the petition?
Thank you. Are we content with those suggestions? Are there any other organisations? Mr. Sweeney.
Obviously, vacant and derelict land is a particularly acute issue in Glasgow. Actually, the bulk of Scotland's derelict land is within Glasgow. I think in that respect, it would be interesting to get insights from the Clyde Gateway Urban Regeneration Company in particular about the work and the model they've adopted, which I think is the only urban regeneration company left in Scotland. So it would be an interesting insight. I think also the Royal Institute of Scottish Architects would be a worthwhile organisation to engage with. Perhaps also CIOB, I think they're called, Charles Institute of Building, because I know they've been proposing an idea around a demolition levy to promote reuse of buildings and renovation of buildings. There's a major disincentive that's been created through the tax system whereby renovation and retrofitting of existing buildings is subject to 20% VAT, but demolition and new build is actually zero rated. So you've actually already got a kind of handicap imposed on what should be the right thing to do in trying to renovate buildings. So that's why you often see otherwise quite pleasant looking architectural buildings destroyed because it doesn't make any sense financially for the developer. So there are some perverse incentives out there that should be investigated, and this perhaps could be part of the remedy.
Very happy to accommodate that suggestion. Are members of the committee content to do so? We'll keep petition open and write to the organisations suggested ahead of further consideration when we have received response. Petition number 1945 to ban the extraction and use of peat for horticulture and all growing media by 2023. Lodged by Elizabeth Otway, the petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to place a legal ban on the extraction of peat imports, exports and sales in order to protect peatlands both in Scotland and worldwide. Elizabeth states that the Scottish Government's investment in peatland restoration is undermined by continued extraction and use of peat in horticulture. The call for the 2023 deadline is in line with the UK Climate Change Committee report, who recommended banning peat extraction, sales and imports by 2023. The Spice briefing notes that we've received note that the Scottish Government commitments to phase out the use of horticultural peat have now been made for several years. The UK Government aims to end the retail sale of peat and peat-containing products in England and Wales by the end of the current Parliament and by 2028 in the professional horticultural sector. The Scottish Government response indicates that a public consultation will be launched shortly to inform its work in relation to banning the sale of peat-related gardening products, and it has commissioned research on the issue. The Scottish Government state that it is committed to setting a timescale for phasing out peat with the introduction of legislation to support this. And in view of this suggestion to us from the Scottish Government, do members have any comments or further suggestions? Mr. Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I think we should keep the petition open and in doing so write to the Scottish Government to highlight the recommendations of the UK Climate Change Committee to ban practices such as rotational burning on peatlands by 2020 and to ban peat extraction and the sale of peat and peat imports by 2023. To ask the government how feasible it would be to ban the extraction and use of peat by 2023 and when the Scottish Government expects to deliver a plan and timetable for phasing out horticultural peat to be developed and produced and when the consultation will be launched and how the petitioner can contribute to this consultation.
Thank you. Do colleagues have any... Did Mr. Ewing...
Yes, I wasn't quite sure whether the petition was calling for restrictions beyond the use of peat for horticulture. From what David Torrance said there and the reference that he made, it would appear that the climate change recommendations seek to go further than that and ban peat for burning. And I wonder if, given that we all know that burning of peat is traditional in crofting counties, a means, essential means of heat and a cultural practice that has gone on for centuries, and any attempt to ban the said practice would be met with horror and a outright opposition, if not direct action by crofters, if we might write to the Crofters Foundation in order to seek their guidance as to who we should be consulting about this, because I suspect that this is an issue that will become, convener, to use a rather poor pun, a burning one.
I wondered from a range of poor puns which one you were going to reach for there, Mr. Ewing. But I'm happy that we do that as well. Are we content, members of the committee? We are. Thank you. Brings us to petition number 1946, to call on the Scottish Government to pay all charges for homeless temporary accommodation lodged by Sean Clarkin, calling on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to use general taxation to pay for all charges for homeless temporary accommodation, including writing off the £33.3 million debt owed by homeless people for temporary accommodation to local authorities. Sean tells us that vulnerable homeless people, including working people, are being forced into serious debt. Sean's recent submission highlights the increase in homeless households in temporary accommodation over recent years and states that this situation will worsen due to the cost of living crisis. He says without the action called for, the financial burden and further poverty will drive many people into physical and mental ill health. The Spice briefing received states that councils use different methods of calculating charges for temporary accommodation and that a Social Bite report found a wide variation in costs ranging from £65 to £400 per week. The Legal Services Agency published a report that noted varying levels of detail in local authority policies and varying regard for and definition of the affordability of temporary accommodation. It also recommends that in the longer term, charging individuals for temporary accommodation should be prohibited. The Scottish Government's response highlighted its forthcoming housing bill, which will seek to prevent homelessness through principles of shared public responsibility, earlier intervention, and increase housing choices for individuals. It has also established a temporary accommodation task and finish group which will review charging practices and affordability concerns. Do members have any suggestions or comments in relation to this petition? Mr. Torrance.
Thank you very much, Convener. Can I ask if the committee could keep the petition open? And in doing so, write to the Scottish Government for the forthcoming housing bill, which will include provision to prohibit local authorities from charging individuals for a provision of temporary accommodation, and if the Scottish Government will give consideration to paying for homeless temporary accommodation and waiving the outstanding debt owed by homeless people to local authorities for temporary accommodation.
Any further suggestions from the committee? We're content, Mr. Stewart.
Well, I'm content, Convener, to support Mr. Torrance's calls because I think, as you've indicated in your opening remarks, there is no question that the cost of living crisis will have a knock-on effect on all of this, and there may well be the need to clarify as to what the housing bill is going to develop so that we can progress that, because without that, as I say, that it could spiral into a much larger situation and circumstances for many local authorities and for many individuals. So I'm content for that to be the case.
Thank you. Paul Sweeney.
I would like to propose that we invite Shelter Scotland to make a submission to the petition. I think they might have important insights.
Okay, thank you. Happy to accommodate that. Any further suggestions? Are we happy to keep the petition open and proceed on the basis, and we can consider the petition afresh when we receive the submissions that we are now seeking? Thank you. Petition number 1947 to address Scotland's culture of youth violence, which has been lodged by Alex O'Kane, and calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to address the disturbing culture of youth violence in Scotland. Alex highlights a culture of youth violence in Glasgow city centre and says children as young as 13-year-olds have been kicked unconscious. Alex told us that these incidents have been videoed and circulated on social media. Alex sent us a further submission highlighting a recent incident involving a young girl and says children should be safe on our streets and young people, and I quote, need to learn about consequences and deterrence or they will simply become adults without fear of consequences and deterrence. The Scottish Government response outlines a number of ongoing programmes and work being undertaken with partner organisations such as the Scottish Violence Reduction Unit and Medics Against Violence. The response highlights a notable decrease in the number of young people frequenting Glasgow city centre and an associated decrease in antisocial behaviour and violence. The Scottish Government states its plan to publish the first National Violence Prevention Framework for Scotland, which seeks to refresh its approach to violence prevention and harm reduction. Now, the submission also notes an 85% reduction in the number of children and young people being prosecuted in courts between 2008 and 2020. In view of the response from the Scottish Government and our thoughts on this important petition, members have any comments or suggestions, Mr Stewart?
Convener, I think this is a very important situation. I know the petition talks primarily about Glasgow, but across Scotland there are without question some areas of locations that suffer the blight of violence and young people who have difficulty in assimilating what they want to do and choose to go out and be involved in antisocial behaviour, in vandalism, and that can sometimes lead to violence. And I think the petitioner has given us some quite strong examples of what has taken place. And the whole idea of social media is used within this context to publicise and promote some of these. And that is a dangerous development as well. So I would at the first step, convener, suggest that the committee may wish to seek from lived experiences across this board, because by doing that we will then get an opportunity to discuss further details with individuals and circumstances that have taken place. And there is a role within this for community safety and the police and other authorities to participate, to have some of them involved would also be very useful, I believe.
Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Convener. This petition was submitted following a spate of violence in Glasgow city centre and surrounding areas, violence which was brought to my attention by the petitioner earlier this year. Since then, there have been several instances where the levels of violence on display have been absolutely horrifying, most notably in the case of 13-year-old Abby Jarvis. I don't want to get into the specifics on that case, as there are currently legal proceedings underway and I don't want to prejudice those. Petition 1947 is known as Abby's petition, following media coverage, and I know that my colleague Polly McNeill, MSP, has been engaging with Abby's family to see what can be done to support them in particular. So I would like to see this petition kept open and progress. I know that the government have responded, setting out the measures they have taken to try and reduce youth violence in Scotland, but I would like to put it to the committee that those measures haven't been adequate, and that in big cities like Glasgow, the situation is getting worse, particularly in the city centre. In my conversations with Police Scotland and with the Scottish Violence Reduction Unit, it appears that there is no one individual reason for that recent increase. Indeed, the problem is multifaceted. I do think that the committee, therefore, would benefit from hearing from the likes of the Scottish Violence Reduction Unit, and if they wish to appear before us, from families who have been directly impacted by youth violence.
Thank you. Mr Stewart's suggestion was that it may also be of interest for us to proactively go and visit communities that have been affected. Does that have some appeal for the committee? It does, so we'll write the organisation also to that. We'll ask the engagement team here to develop a programme potentially from us, and are you happy for them to do that? Yeah. Is there anywhere in particular you would like us to visit bear in mind this will probably be in the new year, given timetables. Any suggestions, or are you happy for the unit to come back to us?
There has been a particular focus of Glasgow. Antisocial behaviour, convener, in the St Enoch Square and informal what's known as the Four Corners area of Glasgow, Argyll Street, under this Helaman's umbrella. So I think that might be an area, but I'm sure the petitioner might also have suggestions.
Okay, so we're content to evolve some recommendations to us and where we might visit, and to plan to do so possibly just in the early new year. That, clerks, take that forward for us. Thank you. And on that basis, we'll hold the petition open. Thank you very much. Petition number 1948, to improve the way that unexplained deaths are dealt with. This has also been lodged by Mr. Alex Kane, and calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to encourage Police Scotland to review their practices for dealing with unexplained deaths, from initial recovery through to the support that is offered to family members. Alex stresses that the vital window of time when a body is discovered with no clear cause of death, when decisions are made and evidence can be secured or lost. Alex says because an unexplained death is not considered to be a crime, the same level of resources are not invested to support the person's family, and victim support is not included. Alex also stresses the need for good and supportive police communication with families in this situation. The Scottish Government's submission sets out the process followed by Police Scotland and the Crown Office and the Procurator Fiscal Service when managing unexplained reportable deaths. Police officers are expected to undertake a range of actions during an initial assessment to determine the response, and if at any stage circumstances indicate a police reportable death, the assessment must be halted and officers must notify supervisors and CID. In dealing with unexplained deaths, one of the key principles highlighted by the Scottish Government is that the deceased and any family of or friends are treated with respect, dignity and compassion. Guidance states that consideration should also be given to the appointment of a family liaison officer for bereaved relatives. Do members have any comments or suggestions? Mr. Sweeney?
Thank you, convener. I've engaged with the petitioner on this petition, which I believe is known as Stephanie's petition. Stephanie Bonner is a constituent who tragically lost her son 3 years ago in what has been recorded as an unexplained death. The family have had no answers, have been let down by the authorities, and are awaiting the outcome of a review by the Police Investigations and Review Commissioner into the handling of their case. Nothing I say today will do the importance of this petition justice, and therefore I am of the opinion that the committee should invite Stephanie herself to give evidence on her experience since the tragic passing of her son 3 years ago. I gave a commitment to the petitioner that I would encourage the committee to invite Stephanie at the earliest opportunity. The first opportunity I've had is during today's session, and I stand by that commitment. Therefore, my request to the committee today that Stephanie is invited to speak to us. Fundamentally, this petition is about improving the way that unexplained deaths are dealt with. In order to do so, it's vital that the committee hears firsthand from those who have experienced the current system, its flaws and the impact that that can have on families who are grieving and seeking answers and closure.
Thank you. So we have a proposal to hear from the petitioner. It might be useful ahead of that just to seek some further information from a variety of other organisations. Do any colleagues have any suggestions in regard to that? David Torrens?
Thank you, Convener. I agree with my colleague Paul Sweeney on actions to take, but can we also write to Police Scotland to get information on how a family liaison officer is deployed, and the role of a family liaison officer, and their training duties and their accountability in situations like this?
I think we can. Any other suggestions? We might write to Victim Support Scotland as well. So, sorry, I made a mistake there, because the petitioner is Alex Akeen, but if there is an individual who is specifically affected by this who would like to give evidence to the committee, I think, can the clerks liaise with Mr. Sweeney in relation to that further? That would be useful. So we're prepared to keep the petition open at this stage and to explore how we take forward the suggestions that have been made. Thank you. That brings us to the last of the new petitions this morning, 1951, to reinstate inshore coastal limit on the use of dredge and trawl fishing gears, submitted by Alistair Bally-Philp on behalf of the Scottish Creel Fishermen's Federation, which urges the Scottish Government to reintroduce a variation of the historic 3 mile coastal limit on the use of mobile dredge and bottom trawling fish gears to support the recovery of Scotland's inshore demersal finfish population and the wider ecosystem. opportunities to optimise the social, economic and environmental returns within the new spatially managed area, and increases in fishing jobs and the revitalisation of coastal communities. The Scottish Creel Fishermen's Federation highlight that the decline in fish landings significant losses of marine features since the removal of the historic inshore limit. They are concerned that despite the use of marine protected areas, less than 5% of Scotland's inshore waters are currently protected from damaging trawling and dredging activity. The Scottish Creel Fishermen's Federation has also shared information on economic studies showing that switching fishing effort from trawl fishery to creel fishery has the potential to, and I quote from them, yield substantial economic, social and environmental benefits to Scotland. In their response to the petition, the Scottish Government state that they have engaged in extensive discussions on this matter with the Scottish Creel Fishermen's Federation, but have no plans to introduce a three-mile limit restricting mobile gear activity in inshore waters. The Scottish Government suggests that there are already a range of measures to protect fish stocks and highlight commitments contained in the Bute House Agreement, including the designation of highly protected marine areas, covering at least 10% of Scotland's inshore and offshore waters by 2026. The petition has already attracted a large number of written submissions, many of which indicate concerns over the Scottish Government's approach to marine management. And on the basis of everything we've received in advance of our consideration this morning, do members have any comments or suggestions? Both Mr Stewart and Mr Torrance are keen to jump in. Mr Torrance,
thank you, Convener.
Deputy Convener.
Considering that there's another committee in Parliament doing work in this area, I would like to refer a petition to Rural Affairs, Islands and Natural Environment Committee for consideration as part of the work on inshore fisheries issues. If that's agreed with my members.
Mr Stewart.
I agree, Convener. I think that the Federation makes some very valid and strong points in this petition, and it would be much more appropriate, I think, for it to go to the Rural Affairs, Islands and Natural Environment, because they already are looking into some studies with reference to fishing in inshore fishery issues. So I think that is the right place to put it, because they will look at that in much more depth and give it the appropriate precision that it requires.
Colleagues, given that another committee of Mr Sweeney.
It's just also, I understand that the, I can't remember what stage it's at, but I believe there's a UK Parliament Fisheries Bill underway, if it's not already passed into statute, but it might be worth contacting the Scotland office to see if there's any input from the UK Government on the matter.
I think we could draw that together with the recommendation when we refer the petition. Are we agreed that given that there is another committee exploring these issues, that we will refer the petition to that committee? We're content? We are. Thank you all very much. That concludes the public section of our meeting this morning. We next meet on the 9th of November, and we will now suspend the committee and go into private session. Thank you all very much.